Now, the one thing that we haven't had a lot of today is actually interaction from the audience. And my prior, what I'd really like, we've got roaming mics, I believe we've got half a dozen of them. We've got more than one anyway. And what I'd really like is to, as much as possible, have this being from you. Questions, please. If you're going to comment, one sentence comments perhaps is allowable, but it's not about lectures from the floor, it's about questions and interaction. Please just tell us who you are, because and where you come from, where you sort of are, your home is, because that helps us to have a dialogue. So I invite you from the floor, please just show of hands if you would like to kick off.
How have you managed to balance your clinical commitments and your managerial commitments and your home commitments to a state where you feel you've done all three of them justice without burning out?
I did burn out once, but I came back. Two, I don't have children. Three, they're completely out of balance. Sometimes I say to people, I've got work-life balance, but it's killing me. But I don't, you know, my father was an accountant. And, you know, sometimes people think, oh, doctors work so hard, it's so tricky. My father was an accountant who ran his own business. He brought work home at night. When it was tax time, he wasn't home for ages. He was on the town council, so he went to meetings for that, and he went to meetings for this. I just think it's part of being a citizen to try and... Not everybody wants to do that. You know, we all make our choices about who we want to be and what job we want to be. And for some, it's more about spending a lot more time with family. For some, it's doing different things. Henry says he doesn't want to retire. I plan to retire. But I think you just have to work out what works for you.
Does anyone else on the family, on the panel have a good work-life balance they'd like to share with us?
Well, I know a little bit about balance. And my son-in-law's an anaesthetist, and I'd say he has his life totally out of balance, really. But it's another story. But I think, for me, understanding balance came from a lecture in seed physiology, where the lecturer stood up and said, kind of life is a battle. It's a battle between the repair processes and the decay processes. And we just have to keep the repair ones a bit healthier than the decay ones.
Good comment.
Sorry, I was just going to say, I think that Dawn makes a very valid point that it is around choice. My mum added up last week that I had 8 plane rides and 112 hours without the plane rides. And I was having the same conversation with my son last night, who worked through the night and into the next day, and said, sweetheart, you've got to stop. This is, you know, this is a choice. You have to choose this. But, you know, sometimes you do get caught in that, and you're wanting to do that greater good and to feed into, you know, the betterment of all. So I think it is a choice. I'm lucky enough that my mother lives 3 doors down the road, and she can help sort of man the front lines at home. But, you know, absolutely, you are making decisions around choices there.
Have we got another question there? Yes, please.
Sorry, Steve Child. I'm a physician at Auckland District Health Board, but also the chair of the New Zealand Medical Association at the moment. A question for the whole panel. You said leadership begins with the vision. As health professionals, we've all put the patient's interests above our own. That's why we go to work every day, and that's why we chose the profession. And yet you've all alluded to the social determinants of health, the healthcare home, the domestic violence, the prison, et cetera. How do you motivate a team that may or may not share the ethical interests of putting the patient's interests first? What's your experience been in that, and particularly, Nick, maybe with healthcare homes and how you're doing in Northland with that, please?
Gosh, Steve, I was hoping you wouldn't ask me. I mean, it's incredibly difficult to, at times, motivate people, particularly in an area that they're not interested in. But I do think everyone is interested in some of the issues around poverty and social injustice and health inequities. So it can be quite a compelling narrative at times. And so I like to talk to clinicians, and actually I meet with all of our clinical directors every month, and they really ask me every time, how are things going out there? What are the things at a population level that they don't get to see? So I just tell the stories, and as far as getting them involved, they're usually willing to do that at some level. But everybody has their own discipline and interest, and so it's understandable that they are very much focused on the patient in front of them, and it's sometimes difficult to also be able to focus on the population. But I think it is really, for all of us, it's actually about our populations. It's not just about that individual patient in front of you. So I don't think I've answered how you do it. I don't know the answer, but I think telling those stories and really being clear about why it's important, and you know, I don't have the answers to a lot of this, and our experience with the healthcare homes and some of the initiatives we're working on is kind of, we're learning as we go, and as I said before, plagiarising wherever we can.
Other members of the panel? Like to add, Dawn?
I think one of the problems is, I mean, I think people do want to do the best for the patient, but people keep asking us to do more and more and more for less, the same money, and we run out of time. So I think that's what has to be considered. I don't know that anybody that I work with who doesn't want to try harder for their patient, but I know of a lot of people that I work out with that run out of time and are frustrated sometimes that the resources aren't there to support them.
Well, I keep bees in my back garden in London, and there's a vast surplus of honey, so I hand out lots of jars of free honey to most members of my surgical department, and that, I feel, entitles me occasionally to ask them to do things they don't particularly want to do.
There you go. There is the answer.
Yes, there's a question here. Have we got a microphone here, please, in the centre? Oh, we got one here too, yes, okay. This one and then over there.
Hello. George is my name. I'm an anaesthetist from Palmerston North. I had two questions. One is the issue of visibility as leaders, whether you feel comfortable that you are visible enough to your team, and also whether there are particular constraints which make particularly chief executives quite invisible to the workers. It's quite hard to actually even bump into a chief executive in a public hospital. The other thing was about apologizing to patients when something goes wrong. Mr. Marsh, I think, mentioned that somebody who is the senior should be going to apologize, but actually shouldn't also be the one who actually made the error be also be there, if possibly the senior, just as a support person.
So there are two lines of question there, yes. Who's going to pick that up?
Well, I commented about my experience of chief executives, and it does seem, I would have thought it wouldn't be that difficult for a chief executive of even a very large hospital to set time aside to go around the various hospital departments, maybe just once a year, on a purely sort of hello, how are you sort of basis. And I've never seen that happen. So I can't entirely believe that's because they're so busy they couldn't find the time, which shouldn't be that time consuming. And I assume that's partly because there is this problem, but as doctors on the wards and in the trenches, it's quite difficult for a chief executive who's rarely a doctor, has little experience of actually dealing with patients, and they probably feel they're on a different planet, and I feel they're on a different planet. And I think it's quite a difficult bridge to cross. As I said, the original Griffiths report, 1983 stressed how important it was that actually there should be a lot of doctors in senior management and management center work. With regard to saying apologies, well, my talk after this is partly about that. I don't know. I mean, it's when it's actually your own mistake, it is extraordinarily difficult to say sorry. Well, I'll talk a bit later about it, but it is very, very difficult is the answer, and most of us run away from it. And I think the government in Britain is deeply naive, saying that you must apologise as though this will actually solve the problem. But I've got no easy answers to it.
Thank you. No, we are fortunate to have a chief executive on the panel.
Another planet.
But I thought I'd try and answer how I do it, because it is challenging, and actually it's quite challenging for us to describe what our roles are sometimes, but the diaries get pretty full, and they're not just about running the hospital, because of course we are district health boards and we have a lot broader roles, but I use two opportunities. So we, every 2 weeks, with my chief medical officer and director of nursing, do a patient safety walk around to one of the clinical areas and spend an hour and a half, hour to an hour and a half with the staff. We take down at least 3 patient safety issues and then undertake to try and address those, and we make it really clear that it's not about building a new ward or putting in lots more staff, but it's a way of engaging. I also try and meet with all of the various doctors' specialties at their business meetings or team meetings once every year or so. I also really try and make sure I attend all the orientations, which is completely useless for doctors because they never attend them. But I then really make an effort for all new senior medical officers, because as I said, you're up to $30 million investments, to meet them. And I try to get to know everybody. But I'm reasonably lucky. We've got probably 150 senior medical officers rather than some of the larger organisations. But I do actively try and get around. But I guarantee if you ask some of my senior medical officers, they'll say, we never see them. So it's really hard when you're a single person, yes, and there's quite a lot of expectation on you.
So I'd like,
and you're coming from another planet.
So I'd like to just make a comment on that. I think that I have increasingly realised that the role of our chief executives, of DHBs, please note, is an incredibly big role and really challenging. And I think most of the ones that I know about actually do their very best in all respects. Also, I've been just trying to think back. I can't remember a CEO for a very long time in our organisation that I haven't had quite a few meetings with. Now, you might say, oh, it's because of who I am today, but actually going right back to when I was a clinical anaesthetist with no other role, I regularly interacted with the CEO, and I think it's a little bit of a two-way thing, that I've never had trouble getting to see them. They haven't always enjoyed it, but I have found it, a very worthwhile exercise. And I can remember Graham Edmonds telling me, actually showing me his job description from the government at that time. And that reminds me how far we've gone, because his job description basically said, make the books balance. And now, partly through the Commission's work, there is an actual explicit expectation that there will also be an emphasis on the outputs, the achievements, the quality, and so forth. So I think there's a two-way thing. I'd like to ask Libby to bring her into this about the apology question from the perspective of the patient. How do you feel about that?
Well, I think really the most important thing is that it's acknowledged that the system recognises what's happened and and is upfront about it so that it can be improved for future patients. I mean, I suppose it's also, of course, important for the patient themselves to get some closure to an issue. But yeah, it's a means of improving processes and acknowledging, ensuring that the system does.
Yes, exactly. Thank you for that. We've got a question here and then another one up there.
Can I just add to the apology? I think it's important to remember that one of the reasons you wouldn't get the junior to apologise is that it's almost invariably a systemic problem. It's not a single person problem. And so one reason for the senior to apologise is they're apologising for the system. The junior who might have made the mistake There's a series of events before that, and so I think it's reasonable for the senior to take the role.
I agree with that. I'm still saying there are no bad soldiers, any bad officers, and we are, you know, when my junior makes a mistake, ultimately that's my mistake, not his or hers. It's my responsibility. And I think that's something one has to accept, and it's a very important part of leadership, that when things go wrong, it's your fault, not your trainees.
We'll be very interested to hear that explored further, and I'll resist the temptation to join in. Who's next on the floor? Thank you.
Namahi koutou, ko Shame Pini Aho, ko DAA Group, Whanganui Atara Tokumaku Mahi. My name is Charmaine Penny. I work at DAA Group, which is a health auditing agency here in Wellington. My question really is about, I'm quite interested in that consumer and how we can, the consumer can participate and have a role in New Zealand and the New Zealand model healthcare around providing that healthcare and that leadership and also in just in that whole participation, protection and partnership. I'm not sure we're there yet. I know we're on a journey, but I'd like to hear about, from your different aspects, about where that's going in your area.
Who'd like to pick that up?
So is that a question for consumers or for people who actually work in the system in different areas? Okay. So from the consumer side, consumer engagement usually happens as a result of advocacy from that consumer side. And it certainly hasn't happened across the health system. There are various groups, but some are much more vocal than others. But it really should be something that that the health system incorporates as a normal part of process because of the value that consumers can add. So I really don't think at the moment that clinical leadership committees normally incorporate the views of consumers or the experiences in the value of consumers into their processes, and that's something systemic at the moment, and I'm sure that our system will improve with that input from across the board from consumers. But so those who are in leadership roles, what's needed to make that happen other than advocacy in particular areas?
And I'll just add to that, I think the system needs to resource the role, not only with, if you're expecting people to give up their time, the usual time-honoured way of doing that is a transaction. And while there's a view that volunteers, there's plenty of people out there to volunteer to do that, I think it was really an important breakthrough to have the role resourced and then training come in so we can build our capability and capacity to do that work and to be able to network with all our kind of consumer groups out there and bring that to the system level table. So building capability to do that around developing the skills as consumers to think very strategically and understand how systems work. So it's kind of resourcing the system to do that. So it's visible and resourcing, I think, is a good start.
That's a very good point.
So, for me, involvement and integrated involvement and integral involvement of consumers is probably our only hope for the future. And so, I'm saying that because I see some of the initiatives that we're starting to get involved in around patient portals and the ability for patients to influence clinical decision making as a huge opportunity, and as we work towards what matters most to patients rather than what's the matter, it's a real opportunity for us to get it right and do the right thing rather than doing things right. But for us, we are on we're on a road of discovery, and so we've got a consumer council, which we certainly pay all of our consumer council members. We interviewed them. There's 15 members of that consumer council. We probably had 30 or 40 applicants, and that consumer council has a governance role. We also have consumers on many of our governance committees now, and it's still coming along. Certainly involved consumers in all of our planning now, so we're making progress, and I think It's something you've just got to start, but you've actually got to be committed to it because it will require some resource. And consumers are fantastic when they just want to be involved and help, and they really do. They make a massive difference. And as we've heard today, their stories and their experience can change. And I think that's probably the way, one of the best ways of motivating clinicians to do things that they don't want to do.
Sorry, just on that last point around empowerment, I was going to add that, yes, we definitely need people and boards and formal structures, etc., but we also need to get smarter about health delivery and how that looks. And I'm involved currently with four projects now where we're working specifically with people in places that they feel able to share all about their medical history, working collectively with people to empower them. One project that I was involved with in Opotiki, we worked with the whole community so that they understood the condition we were looking at. There was gout, we've got respiratory projects and cardiovascular things going on as well. But this project around gout, we empowered the community to understand what best practice looked like and how that should be delivered. So they were fronting up in primary care, knowing exactly what their serum urate should be, what the best pathways for prevention look like, all those parts of the system. And that was really quite a powerful thing because it then enabled them to interact around other conditions. It enabled them to speak out about a number of different disease states, etc. And the whole community got on board with it, and we were working alongside the providers and the rheumatologists too from the area. So, you know, I think we do have to get smarter about the models that we're looking as well as the formal structures too, and of course recompensing the consumers that are involved in that space.
Thank you for that. Well,
there's a fundamental problem in healthcare, but most of it is handed out by fit young doctors and nurses, as I was once upon a time, who have literally no idea what it's like to be a patient. And it's a common observation by doctors that as we get older, either we have illnesses ourselves or our family do, we start to understand what it's really like to be a patient. And the only way of bridging that gap, and yes, to some extent, hopefully, teaching helps, but if you have patients as consumers, if they're involved at an earlier stage, trying to explain to all these fit, healthy, arrogant young people what it feels like to be a patient, I think it's hugely important. But it's difficult to organize, of course. And just pushing somebody on a trolley down a corridor gives you some idea of what a profoundly humiliating, undignified process it is to be a patient. And believe you me, most of us don't realize that when we're young doctors. We have no understanding of it at all.
With yourself being an exception because of your role working as an orderly in exactly that kind of capacity. Very, very interesting. Dawn.
I think it's important. I think all those things are really good, but we have to remember that some people can't advocate for themselves. And my patients, I've never seen a complaint where a parent made a complaint, I took my child to ED with a broken arm and they didn't work out that it was because I bashed them. So we have a whole group of people that need us to advocate for them. They can't advocate for themselves. I see so much good work done by parents who, the SIDS story has been a great story of parent involvement. The oncology story, parents are behind getting services for oncology children, but the children who are abused and lived in violent homes don't have parents to advocate for them, so we have to do that.
Now we have a couple more questions. We're going to run out of time. Who's next? We've got someone with a microphone and then a person. There you are, okay. Which, yes, please go ahead, sir.
Hi, my name's, is that work? My name's Tom Thompson. I'm a physician at Hutt Valley DHB. This is a question about efficient use of the constrained resource, which is clinical leadership. I wonder if anybody on the panel has worked in systems where I suppose managers and clinicians have worked together to prioritise service development activities. But Martin Sneddon's comment about, you know, who's the boss? Is it the CEO or the coach or the captain? sometimes my experience is that, you know, the CEO might have a good idea, the clinicians have got good ideas, middle management have got good ideas, everybody's got a good idea, everybody wants to do their good idea, but the problem is that there just isn't enough sort of clinical leadership capacity to really execute these things. And I just wondered if anybody had any thoughts about, you know, how that discussion, I suppose, could be more effectively conducted and better decisions made about what to do.
So who'd like to pick that one up? I'm going to make one comment, though. There's a really, I'm not sure that I agree entirely, but I think there is an interesting issue, which is that busy clinicians tend to be busy looking after patients at the time that administrators in hospitals are having meetings. And so actually getting those two groups to meet together turns out to be logistically quite difficult. And of course, the reference of going to the dark side, if you stop doing clinical work and move over, it's an interesting challenge. Nick.
Oh.
From the dark side and another planet, please.
I just completely agreed with you that it's a huge challenge. I guess the one thing I'd say is if leadership was everybody's business, and I talked about collective leadership, it might take some of the pressure off the few, but clearly leadership activities and clinical leadership needs to be resourced. But I know, just as everyone else does, that that resource is somewhat constrained, and so you're getting into that discretionary effort and potentially burnout. So it's a really difficult one, and I completely acknowledge that you get pulled so many different ways. But I do think there's some hope if we can get everyone to take some form of leadership role, because it's not fair loading it all onto the clinical director or one or two people in a department.
Leanne, you're a shining example of clinical leadership. Would you comment?
Sorry, I wasn't...
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to put you.
Yes, I mean, absolutely. I've had these same discussions with Chai many a time. You know, we keep resourcing the system that currently isn't delivering. You know, why are we perpetuating that model? I know when I had my own sort of, you know, I qualified as a prescriber and I wanted my own system around that. And I certainly wasn't buying into the current model where you're under-resourced and you're under-timed. And I'd been out and I'd engaged with the communities that were involved and how they wanted it to look. And, you know, I think that's a really good point that we have to think smarter in this space about how that is going to look. And the model that I use isn't the traditional, you know, 10 minutes get you out the door type thing. So, you know, you have to advocate in that space for those spaces to happen. They certainly don't happen otherwise, and it is stretched. Someone's clearly not with you on that question, Alan.
Yeah, no, that's good. I think you've given the answer. Look, I'm going to take the prerogative of asking the last question because we're going to run out of time, and I'm actually going to direct it to Libby. And we've heard from Martin Sneddon about the importance of the story. So, what should our story be for New Zealand's healthcare following today?
Well, that's a tricky one, just encapsulate the whole...
Yes, with a lot of warning, too, to think
day.
About
yeah,
it.
Yeah, thanks for that. I mean, honestly, I think we can do better, and I do believe that collaboration and synergy can happen between consumers, but also among clinicians at different levels of the system. So it's about trust and working together and sharing decisions, and we can have a world-class health system despite limited resources, if we just do it smarter and work together and call on that synergy, everybody's power, tangata tu, pakari tonu, together we're stronger.
Fantastic, what a great note to finish on. Will you all join me, please, in thanking the panel?